Welcome to the Journey of an Aesthete podcast, a comprehensive examination of all things aesthetic, the arts, the humanities, and what it means to be human. Welcome to Journey of an Aesthete. In this particular episode, we're going to try to accomplish two things at once, at the same time. I am going to talk about a movie by the great Martha Coolidge, one of our finest directors, seriously. We're going back to 1983. Can you imagine? 1983, the movie is Valley Girl. Nicolas Cage, Deborah Foreman, an impossible to describe true love story, a classical love story inspired by Shakespeare's Romeo and Juliet, but set in the heart of Southern California, Los Angeles, and Hollywood, and it's just a beautiful film. And I'll get into this a little bit later, but it's a perfectly balanced classical film, almost like the kind of picture that the Hollywood studios made in the 30s and 40s, you know, except this happened to have been made in 82, 83, which is something. And I also want to get a little personal with my audience today, talk about some things in my personal life, not excessively so, but hopefully. But I've been listening to some other podcasts, and sometimes podcasters will get personal and talk about struggles they've had. And, you know, I'm just turned 52, and when this movie came out, you know, being the age of 13, 14 is different than being 52, and a lot can happen. A lot can happen in the decades. So, so I don't really know where to begin first. I mean, I think I have to talk about my producer, actually. Because Laurie Jill Strickland knows all about this. So she knows not only about the world of acting, both on stage and in film, but knows about production and producing and making things. My whole show, Journey of Aesthete, is actually about making things. The whole show is about people that make things, and the thing made is a little bit less important than the making itself. So I would suggest to you that if you make a poem, or if one of our guests has made a poem, if they recite it, if they speak it, if they write it down and publish it with Yale University Press, or if they if they bellow it on a street corner, or if they make a needlepoint, if they make a portrait painting, if they make a song, if they play violin, if they sing, if they make sculpture, or if they make a studio film for Hollywood, 1983, that it's basically all the same thing, actually, because the meaning of it is the unity of all the arts, and of course the arts, all arts are personal. They're about personal life. So they're actually always about, in some degree, about the struggles and experiences of their creator. So this show is no exception. I have to talk a little bit about myself. I don't want to be boring when I do. Hopefully this will not be a dull episode, but because my life at times might appear quite uneventful. I mean, today I spent 2 hours trying to figure out a couple of chords, and I was figuring out some very, you know, some this piano piece, and I was struggling with this chord, these measures, and I was, it could, you know, if you weren't a musician, it might get a little bit like washing paint dry, you know, but I've had some experiences in my life, and so I'm lucky to have my producer here. Did you want to talk to the audience or say hi?
Oh, hello there,
Larry Jill. It's Laurie Jill Strickland.
Oh, what an honor to be on your show, Mitch, both on the mic and off the mic.
Yeah, it's a big deal. I sort of think in a way, because you in a way started this, because I have not thought about this movie for 20 years. I haven't watched this movie in 20 years, and you know, I rewatch a lot of movies.
Oh, yeah. I don't know if your audience knows that you're actually, even though this podcast is not specifically about cinema,
right?
Like exclusively.
No, yeah.
That
no.
You are a cinephile. I mean,
am
you
quite
are
serious,
literally Mitch's encyclopedic knowledge.
In fact, of this movie, it's really interesting because you gave me the movie poster, and this was the original damn poster for the movie.
It's so funny.
It's so beautiful, isn't it?
It is. We're looking at it right now, we're going to link it in the notes. So if you've never seen the film, you'll know what in the world we're talking about in the entirety of the history of cinema.
I think it's a classic, though.
It is a classic. And why we chose this film to frame this episode, out of all the hundreds of thousands of films. Mm. In fact, before we started recording, we were just talking about how we're going to explain it to our beautiful audience, how it is we came to pick this one film.
Yeah.
But, you know, really it says everything about creative process. Like even how you make a podcast or create an episode is the same as how somebody sets out to lay out a quilt and stitch it together. Like it's something about a story, something in the story. So it's just funny even within the medium of a podcast how things come into being. Because we have so many guests that we're excited to share with you guys in interviews. But also this idea that every so often Mitch would do a solo episode. Or in kind of stitch the quilt together, if you were, about his own journey, both as a pianist but also as a podcast host, and how you put shows together and curate them and, you know, bring guests together and explore stories and randomly, sort of, but then an art it never is. The synchronicity was it was your birthday.
Oh, yeah.
And we both have in common a love for the film Valley Girl.
Yes, that is true.
We could have a whole episode about my love for the movie Valley Girl, but this one's about you. But I just thought, oh, it'll be so great if I can find a vintage, authentic poster to give you for your birthday.
Yeah.
And I tracked one down, and it's an original movie poster that, you know, premiered with the film outside some theater somewhere in our world. And I sent it to Mitch. And then the next thing I know, you call me, and you're like, I'm going to do a whole episode about Valley Girl, about this film. And and about the memories it evoked, and how a piece of art, whatever that art artifact is, so in this case it's a film, but how it can take you on a journey, and not to beat you on the nose, it's probably too late, but the show's called Journey of an Aesthete. So that was already too on the nose alert.
Yeah.
But just that it's a frame, if you will, like a movie poster led us to a film, which led you to a specific time in your life.
Yeah, it's powerful. You know, the example people use is Proust and the Madeleine. That narrator bites into this food, piece of food. It's a Madeleine. And then it opens up things about the narrative. And, you know, a woman he was in love with, the narrator. And so this is, you might say that the Valley Girl poster is the Madeleine, right?
Mm-hmm.
Except we're going back to a strange time, the early 80s.
Take us back. Which year are we going to in the time machine, Mitch?
It's 1983.
Wow. So what are we wearing in 1983?
Well, I had not yet discovered my classic style that I've been doing now for 40 some years, but it was related to that.
Mm-hmm.
Kind of like a more pop version of it. So I was wearing a lot of skinny Nagahan vinyl ties. I don't think they were leather, but they were skinny and black and scarlet, much like, you know, the early 80s. It was the shoulder pads and the skinny ties. And I was going to places like Chess Cane.
Oh, yeah.
Merry-go-round.
We'll link those in the notes in case you don't know what we're talking about.
I don't know. Yeah. And so I was a creature of the times. Yeah. And
I think I saw Valley Girl, which, by the way, just synchronistically, I was obsessed with. I mean, this show isn't about my experience with Valley Girl.
We'll have an after-hour show about that.
It could go on forever. Obsessed with my feathered hair. And I think I remember going through a whole can of Final Net. Mm. A whole can, everybody. And I won't link my picture to this in this time in this episode. If I did, we'd all get a good laugh. But that hair was feathered and shellacked. And
that's amazing.
I think I had on some acid wash jeans and some kind of like prairie shirt. All I know is...
Prairie shirt.
I saw this film.
I actually don't know what a prairie shirt is.
It was something off the shoulder, gingham situation.
Oh, I see, yeah.
But all I know is I saw this film. I'd never seen anything like it. Well, then the music was... I mean, come on. We'll link that below too. To the soundtrack.
Well, we're talking about Tears for Fears in modern English.
We're talking about Melt With You.
Yeah, we're talking about Electric Avenue.
Oh, yeah.
Eddie Grant.
Yeah.
The soundtrack is the soundtrack of that era. And
I remember, now in hindsight.
Josie Cotton.
Yes.
Johnny, Are You Queer?
And, oh, yeah, all the classics.
Yeah, all the classics.
All I know is I remember thinking, even then with a limited knowledge on this topic, I remember thinking, this is about soulmates. This isn't just about like teenage obsession. This is deep. Whatever's going on in this film, I don't even think I understood. But I knew whatever it was. I was in a pool of tears, and I was convinced that was the bar for love, whatever this film was doing.
Well, it's an extraordinarily beautiful film about love and sex, both, interestingly enough. Because as I said earlier, female and male sexual heterosexual desire is flagrantly on display.
Mm-hmm.
You know, because you have these teen girls, they're in lingerie, they're in swimsuits, they're very attractive, but yet when they get together, they're talking about Nicolas Cage and how hot he looks. It's almost like the film expresses everybody's desire, which is unique for film to sort of give everybody their say and their feelings or expresses. So even though the film is definitely from a female point of view, there's also male desire in the film as well. There's Lee Purcell. You know, the mom that's hot and all that. But it gets even more complicated, right? Because that's the first, the kind of the more sensational aspect of the movie. But the movie is this classical love story that is on an order of brief encounter kind of stuff.
Romeo
and Juliet. It's based on Shakespeare's Romeo and Juliet, and it means business. The film means
business.
It
doesn't play around. And this is the thing.
It's so beautiful.
You know, I remember when I saw this, I cried so hard, I couldn't breathe. And even now, rewatching it, because we rewatched it, you know, for this episode to refresh ourselves, I still felt, even at a different time in my life, I still feel the same way about it.
Yeah.
And I wonder if this film would get made now with the kind of care it was made then, because this is a very adult film. Like, it doesn't exploit anything, which is so interesting. Like, it's not just
human.
A teen sex movie.
No.
It could have easily been.
It's a real love story.
In different hands. But it's actually a very mature...
It's hard to make a good love story. It's hard. It's not easy.
Yeah.
People think that's an easy thing. Boy meets girl.
But then again, and I'm aware that we're not really specifically a film podcast.
Yeah.
So your reason for wanting to do an episode about this particular film... Because as a cinephile, I mean, you could take us through so many films, and you might. Mitch might have a whole separate podcast just for films at some point, but he's got his hands full right now.
That's being forced into it. Yeah.
I might strong arm him, but know he really, truly is a cinephile. Like, he knows his stuff. But really, this film has taken you on a journey in the Wayback Machine to 1983 in your own life, which in a way is really the whole point of your show, which is what aesthetics can do. how it can reveal to us our humanity,
absolutely.
How it can connect us to one another, whether you're a quilter, unschooled, yeah. unschooled meaning self-taught quilter in a corner of the world, or you're in the Guggenheim, or you're, you know, like across any art form, music.
Yeah, it could be Judy, it could be, well, I could tell you what I was looking at art-wise when this came out, because 1983, I went to a show of Red Grooms. Chicago. He recreated the city of Chicago in the Whitney or MoMA. And there's a picture of me sitting because he had sculptures where you can sit like on the subway train with his papier-mâché. Red Grooms was just genius, brilliant.
So how old were you when you saw Valley Girl for the first time?
I think I saw it the year after it came out because unfortunately I was living in Tampa, Florida. And even though I did visit New York City a lot then, because part of the culture clash in my life, because there's a culture clash in this film between West Hollywood and the Valley suburbs and downtown Los Angeles, I had a culture clash having both my family having lived in New York City, Manhattan, and then being displaced and living in Tampa, Florida, very different cultures in the early 80s. Just navigating those differences was very challenging.
Yeah, so if you don't know the film, well, first of all, give it a look. We'll link to it. I sound like I'm working for Valley Girl.
Well, no,
like, well, we're going to link to all of this.
Yeah,
it is a masterpiece.
Yeah, it's a deep film.
It's just also so you'll know, like, what in the world are they talking about? You'll have a frame of reference. Yeah. But, I mean, in a way, what we're really talking about is memory.
Yeah.
But we're accessing it through the frame of this film.
This film, yeah.
And it reminds me of your trailer when you first created this show, that we're going to go across all the mediums and what it means to be human. I would say this also falls into what it means to be human part of it. Because I'm sure all of us listening to this have read a book or heard a piece of music or seen a piece of art or encountered a novel or watched a film that rocked us, that changed our world or moved us. I mean, I would imagine anybody listening to this podcast is coming to a podcast with the word Aesthete in it because they're drawn to something in that word or what that might stand for. Or maybe you've heard, you care about one of the guests we've had, but you know what they're about. Like, there's a certain energy, I think, to that.
Absolutely.
So any of us right now on this podcast have had a moment where something has moved us
somehow. It's a pretty serious thing when that happens.
It is.
And it probably could be talked about more than one level. So, like, this film is very sociological. Even Martha Coolidge says that this is a document of the Los Angeles of that period and the rock clubs and the energy and... It's pretty, so that's more of a sociological level. But then there's like this other very internal level. And so maybe the reason why I like watch this movie is I used to watch it on VHS because the tape was available. You know, it was there, meaning that we didn't, hardly I had any video cassettes, none. We didn't rent much, very minimalist. I mean, just my life didn't, you know, and it's one of the very few films, this and... that was actually didn't have a bunch of commercials spliced into it. You know, because sometimes people would just record the commercials off of television and stuff. But any event.
So listeners in the Wayback Machine, if
right,
you don't know what a VHS, we'll link to that too, to the wiki page so you know what a VHS is. I'm kidding.
I love this film. I mean, part of it is a family connection because, you know, my family was in the health industry.
Really?
In the health, that's right, health. Not foods, but cosmetics. And of course, you know, the parents of the female lead, they run a health food store, Foods for Health. And
in the film.
In the Valley. And so it's also that, you know, seeing that industry represented, and it's very funny too. But
Well, am I right about this, Mitch, that actually in this film, your family's business poster appears?
Yes, it does.
I mean,
it
that's interesting.
Yeah, it was a beautiful illustration done by our art department that made its way. But it actually brought back memories of standing behind the guy drawing that.
Wow.
Called Welcome, I think it's Welcome to Mother Nature. Or I forget, and there's a woman's face and all the... So this is a rich film. And also, of course, we could talk, you could prompt me and ask me questions because otherwise I maybe... you're going to have to...
You called me,
yeah,
we were getting together to tape many interviews, which I encourage your audience to check back in because we got some good stuff coming up in 2020.
Really cool. Yeah.
You know, we... we like to slow cook them in the crock pot over here. So we're editing, but next year you're going to hear a lot of what we've been recording now. And I remember the phone ringing and getting this excited phone call, like, we're going to do this special episode about Valley Girl. Yeah. And because Mitch is a cinephile, which is great, I'm always reminding us that, you know, we're not only a film podcast, that we're exploring all the arts. Mm-hmm. And so I'm listening to his pitch, basically, for his own show. Mm-hmm. I'm like, okay, why are we going to do this Valley Girl episode? What, I mean, if we're going to review the film, that's great. Mm-hmm. But is that what we're going to do? And then you opened up the door and said, well, it's that, but really, it's what the film reminds you of. Mm-hmm. It's that the film took you in the Wayback Machine of your own life.
Yeah.
And I found that really interesting because, again, that goes to the heart of the show, which is the journey of an aesthete. Now, all of us listening on some level are aesthetes because we're on this journey with you. You're curating. You're opening all these doors to these different artists for us, right? You're saying, hey, I want you to check out Miley's sound art, and I want you to go into John Joss films. And I could go on and on. Mm-hmm. All the guests we've had and all the ones that haven't aired yet.
Mm-hmm.
So you're saying to us, hey, I want to walk you through this film called Valley Girl in 1983.
Yeah.
And I want you all to put on your leather bolo ties and your feathered hair and your hot pink dresses. And I want you to step back in the Wayback Machine with me.
Because members only jacket.
And members only jacket.
And Hane 10.
Probably some acid wash
Hane 10,
in there somewhere.
Hane 10 polo shirt.
Was acid wash part of that year too?
I've never worn it. So
anyway, I digress. Yeah. So, but you also said, you also, if you don't mind, shared that the film took you back to a very specific time in your life. First
like
love.
That. Yeah, it's hard.
Yeah.
It was hard, yeah.
And you were excited, as I recall, to basically explore and share what it is that film, and you could substitute like a Mad Libs, like another art form, like novels, music, what have you. In this case, a film, the power it has to take you back to some place, or to take you forward, as it were. But in this case...
Well,
so, yeah, tell me more about that.
I went to an independent day school, which was a very radical free school in 1977, where the headmaster only came there about 3 days a year.
What was this school?
It was like independent school. It was kind of an independent, it was like a day school. It was a very experimental, like fifth grade, sixth grade.
Interesting.
Yeah, and this is 1977, and the headmaster had a customized van that we would paint, stuff like that. And he had a long beard and long hair. But in any case, it was this girl that I was really crazy about who was a couple years older than me. And we hung out together. And we went to see the movie Annie Hall twice.
And how old were you when you saw Annie Hall?
10.
Okay, that pretty much says everything we need to know.
We went together. She and I both loved this movie. But it's funny, I lost track. As we left childhood and moved into adolescence, I lost track of her.
Mm-hmm.
And so I guess I reunited with her. Around the time I had watched this damn movie on VHS, and I hadn't seen her in years, and I thought she would still be the hippie girl I remember, because even though she was about 11, 12, she still, you know, very, her style was very peasant blouse. And
now we know what a peasant blouse is.
Yeah, peasant blouse. Yeah. But she totally changed her look when I had this date, and she drove, by the way, because I couldn't drive. She drove. We went to the mall. And the mall is just like the damn mall in this film.
Yeah,
same
in Valley
colors.
Girl, there's a mall.
There's a lot of malls.
A lot
it's
of
important.
Mall culture.
Mall culture. And this girl was growing into a woman. And she showed up in this same dress that's in this poster.
And the poster
Fuchsia.
Will be linked below
linked
in case
below.
You don't know what we're talking about.
But. It's a certain style of dress. It's quite with the low slum belt, you know?
Yeah.
And is it Pepto-Bismol or Fuchsia? I don't know the color.
Kind of a mixture, a mashup of
Pepto-Bismol.
We'll call
it. No, it's really attractive. But I had not used to seeing Lisa like this. This is totally makeup.
Now, is that her real name, Lisa?
No.
Okay. I like the classiness of you substituting the name.
Yeah.
Good job. But if you're listening, Lisa, who knows?
Yeah.
Now, had you already seen Valley Girl before she drove you to the mall?
I misremembered it. I misremembered that I saw the movie with her. This shows the power of getting memories wrong.
Hmm.
But I clarified my memory. I realized, you know, this movie never played in Tampa. Either she and I saw a different movie, or we didn't see a movie at all and just had sushi. I think we just had sushi because we went to this new, and I'd never eaten sushi before.
And sushi
she introduced me to
a key thing in this film.
Yeah, it's important to the characters. I mean, Nicolas Cage has never seen sushi, yeah. And of course, the suburbanite, Deborah Foreman, I forget the name of the character, Julie. Julie, of course, was well acquainted with sushi.
Again, right? This whole clash of worlds.
Classic culture.
Like the sushi-eating Valley Girls.
Versus Mohawks.
Versus Mohawks and kind of the new wave slash punk, you know, grittier.
Yeah.
West Hollywood.
Beautiful. You see the Pussycat Theater in this film.
A lot of, actually, that is in a way, and I'm not saying it's like Tarantino, but it is a very much a little bit of a love letter to L.A.
It is a love letter to Los Angeles.
To both, to the Valley and Hollywood.
I can go even further if you want to talk. Of course, that Tarantino film is good in that regard, but also, it's interesting, my other favorite movie of all time is Model Shop by Jacques Demy from 1969.
We'll link to that,
which is
too.
Also a
We're
love
gonna
story.
We're going to have a lot of links on this one.
With the wonderful actor from 2001, Lockhart. Lockhart and Anouka May. It's a man that falls in love with a woman who's French. In Los Angeles. So maybe there's something about California love or lovers. I don't know. Maybe it's the...
I don't know. I was in a small town in Georgia, and I watched Valley Girl, and I was...
Oh, I had never been to California.
I feel like it schooled me on love, and I was in some bumpkin corner of Georgia. So Valley Girl, I think, elevated my consciousness compared to where I was in the South what love could be.
Well, that's an important... We mentioned Shakespeare's Romeo and Juliet, and... Mm-hmm. You know, there are works of art that are about edification. They teach the virtues, and that's very classical. Everybody needs an anchor in life. You, me, just everybody. Anchor made this whole show possible. I'm immensely grateful to them. You too can use Anchor to make your own shows and create your own vision. Download the Anchor app or go to anchor.fm to get started. Thank you. Mm-hmm. Did I mention Frank Capra? I mean, this movie is like a Frank Capra
really
film.
It is.
Almost in that it's so perfectly balanced. And, you know, as far as the virtues that it's teaching, I mean, it's not a preachy film, although the dad is kind of preachy in that scene.
But
he's trying to help his daughter.
Not like now.
No, that's true.
See, that's the thing about this film that's fascinating is that in some hands, it could have been a teen sexploitation film. In other hands, it could have been super immature and just really like about nothing. But in this filmmaker's hands, which you could say a little more about, it becomes something like all the characters are fully formed, even the teenagers.
Yeah.
They're never sort of talked down to or judged.
They're totally realized.
It's actually totally there are these 360 fully realized characters that are all fighting for something they either want or
even
believe
if what they're fighting for is wrong.
Sure, but they're
like
still
conformity or just wanting to.
There's a lot of poetic passages in the film.
Mm-hmm.
But that, all while fascinating, again, would be really, really compelling in a film podcast.
Yeah.
But this is not exactly why we're going down this road. No.
So what are we doing?
So remind me, you called me and you said, I want to do this episode about Valley Girl. And I said, like, you know, producers can be tough sometimes. I'm like, well, are you doing a film podcast review?
Yeah, what are you doing?
And you said, no.
No.
What was the real reason you wanted to explore Valley Girl? I mean, yes, the film.
Well, I was trying to figure out my life when I was 13, 14. I didn't know what was going on.
I mean, I'm still trying to figure out mine now, but no, I'm kidding.
I mean, I was really confused because I was shuttling between these two worlds of sophisticated New York and Tampa, Florida. It's just, and then this girl, the second date, it was my first kiss, and that did not go well.
Oh,
it really, really did not go well.
Hmm.
Because I kissed this girl and she winced, but she had a strange fart. It was just really awkward, really difficult.
Boy. My first kiss was awkward too. Maybe there's something about Valley Girl and awkward first kisses.
I don't know.
But mine would make you laugh so hard we'd have to end this episode. So I'll tell you off the mic.
Maybe you should.
Maybe I'll do a special episode just about that. But anyway, back to you and Valley Girl.
It's like we're doing a weekend update. Right? But but that's really painful. Like, that experience was really painful for me because I never really had any kind of So there was something really pure that I thought love that we had as children. This was all changed because she had changed, and I was. It was just very confusing. I actually didn't know my emotions at all, or what I was experiencing. In fact, I was so confused about why she didn't feel the same way about me that I felt about her, which is strange because to me, like, time did not move. I was the same. I was still 10 at 14.
Interesting.
She had moved. She had decided she didn't like me anymore or whatever. Or she, you know, that now, you. It's not about what's better or what's worse. It's just different. I was still in the same spot. I was like, let's pick this up, even though we're, in fact, it's going to be better now because we're adults, right? So it was not to be. It was really devastating. But I had many other problems. I mean, a lot of my time was spent trying to learn the piano, which I assure you was all perspiration. I had a little inspiration. But it was a lot of hard work.
And, you know, even if you've listened to our podcast and you've heard the intro, outro music, that's Mitch. But you can always, and I'll link it below, just for perspective, if you listen to Mitch's music, he would never want me to say this, but it's too late now because I'm on a mic and he can't stop me. I mean, you know, if you listen to like 10 bars of his music, you'll understand the dedication you were putting in at this time.
That's true.
I think it'll be very clear to you. I mean, you're a professional journeyman musician, you're a composer. So you weren't just sort of dilly-dallying around with the piano.
And I was also just starting Interlochen Arts Academy, and that's a whole other
Interlochen, we'll link to that too. But that's a really amazing school.
It is a great school. It's I haven't been there in some time, but the school changed my life because basically going to that school is like going to college.
Yeah.
It was like college and high school. It's almost like I skipped high school, went from junior high to university.
Right.
And the attitude of the students is pretty serious.
Yeah.
And the, you know, the kind of teachers
we're going to do a whole episode about
Interlochen. We will eventually. I've discussed it before.
We should probably go there and do the interview.
Yeah, we probably should. Or, well, you know, in Michigan, like in the woods of Michigan, eat cherry pie.
Well, that sounds like a great road
trip. We'll pick cherries and
we'll won't go when it's snowing.
Oh.
But back to Valley Girl. So all of this context, like you're shuttling between families. From sophisticated New York culture to, let's just say that Tampa might have been a little bit in a dry spell. Yeah. No pun intended, is in Florida. That's not really a pun, but you get what I mean. But really, like, when you thought about, when you saw the movie poster I sent you, and then you thought, you rewatched the film and you thought about this episode.
Oh, wow. I felt like both the pain of not being able to realize love when you wanted to. Just the pain of that, the loss. But also there's a little bit of happiness. It's a very strange mixture. I think it is bittersweet. It's a very strange, because I think, you know, it's youth. I was young, and there was a sense of possibility, you know. As cliched as that is. It's a sense of so for example, possibility of starting this exotic high school in the woods in Michigan, and even though, you know, seeing somebody wearing clothes like that, I'd never seen hardly any... At that time, girls wearing more sophisticated clothing or a dress like that. That's something I didn't see every day. So that was unusual. So there is a little bit of possibility. And just basically trying to find your way in the world. And I would say try to do the best you can. Because she was trying to do the best she could. And I was trying to do the best that I could. And that's a very difficult but actually more rewarding way to look at it.
Now, this is interesting to me.
And I was starting to go to a psychiatrist, but that's a whole other time.
Wow, we got a lot of extra shows to do in between our interviews. But I mean, I do think actually there's value in that. Because I'm often saying to you that if your podcast is like a quilt, or let's say, I always say pearl, like a necklace made of pearls. You know, like really fine necklaces made of pearls have those knots in between, and they're made with really fine thread, and that's what holds them all together. And I often will say when we're going over podcast episodes that the string in this is you. Like, you're the aesthete taking us on the journey.
Yeah, alas and alack, it is me. I mean, you're not always wanted to be me.
I mean,
in
a way, you're taking us on this journey.
I am.
If we take the title of the show,
you have me
Journey
to blame
of an Aesthete podcast.
Or curse or credit.
And then we're all aesthetes on a journey, too.
Well, I mean, I think that's true,
And we may hear an episode in our minds and hearts may go down tributaries that you don't even imagine.
I've listened to podcasts, and I've really enjoyed them.
Yeah.
Where the guests on that show have very deeply personal connections to the material, and it could be a pop movie. I heard a Mike White's podcast just on Solaris by Tarkovsky. That's a very complex
And he'll
film.
Be on our show. That'll be airing in the new year.
But these folks on the show are trying to wrestle with this movie, and they get into the weeds on it.
Well, I mean,
but
it's
Tarkovsky.
I mean,
what I'm saying is Martha Coolidge's Valley Girl.
Yeah.
Has something to say, is worth it, about love, and it's basically talking about I guess I call them the classical virtues. I don't know how else to frame them. It has to do with internal feeling. Like, she knows how she feels about Randy, Julie, and he knows how he feels about her.
Randy and Julie are main, the main characters.
And it's Nicolas Cage, and it's Deborah Foreman.
And it's his first film, isn't it?
I think it is.
Or one of his first films?
Yeah, he's just
extraordinary. And listen, Nicolas Cage in this movie is like a thing of beauty. But anyway,
it's that physical acting that I like so much.
But
not everybody does.
There's a purity in this film.
Oh, yeah.
There's a purity in this film about what love could be or is that is timeless.
That's
the eternal
part of it.
It wouldn't matter when, but it's because it's not treated like a teen film in quotes, like I'm doing air quotes. Yeah. It's treated like a fine film about the nature of love.
As I said, I was as bold as to compare it to David Lean's Brief Encounter.
Yeah.
It's in that or
even if there's leather bolo ties and winged hair, it's still
it could be that. Yeah.
And it's really good work, like all the work in it.
It's beautiful.
And in the notes, you know, when you read the interviews, Martha Coolidge treated this. It was her first feature, or it was her first
Joy of
greenlit.
Sex,
it
which
was her,
is another an amazing.
It was her first greenlit major studio picture.
Yeah.
And that she wasn't doing it to impress anybody. Mm. She was doing it because she had the opportunity to make a film.
She seized it.
And she was nervous about it being a teen film until she read the script.
Yeah.
And she's like, wow, this could be something special.
Yeah.
And tell me a little bit, but I mean, we're still going to go back to the personal. But
oh boy,
tell me though, am I right that they had almost no budget? That
they had almost
wore their
no budget,
clothes?
And they shot it in 20 days.
Right, 20 days.
That's a quick shoot.
No
huh?
budget. She called in all the favors in her film school. Mm-hmm. People she had done favors for in films.
Right.
They brought their own clothes. This was a labor of love.
And
but
the clothes
there
were amazing.
But
that's
there's some fine actors in this.
All the actors,
like Frederick Forrest.
Frederick Forrest and Colleen Camp, or her parent, or Julie's parents, and they're both terrific. Colleen Camp is one of my favorites.
They're great.
Frederick Forrest, they were both in Apocalypse Now together. And
this film was right after that.
Right after that, yeah. And then, of course, Lee Purcell. Mm-hmm. Can't forget her. And there's a whole host of young actors.
But I want to go back to
Heidi Holliker and Michelle and Cameron Dye, his best friend.
Mm-hmm. But something I want to go back to that really intrigues me by this.
Yeah.
I can't let it go, is that... Yeah. So in a way, a film, and again, if this were a Mad Lib, fill-in-the-blank novel, piece of music, like a fine piece of food even, a smell, a texture, a quilt, a painting, a piece of pottery. Mm. I mean, we could just go on and on. And so if I'm skipping someone's art form, I apologize, but you get what I'm saying.
Right.
Somehow or another, that can take us back in the way back time machine.
Mm.
But it also can take us forward because there's something interesting you said about, and I'm paraphrasing. It was only a few minutes ago, but I need more coffee. You're saying that the film at that time, while it was a bittersweet time, but it also had a hope in it of what was possible, something to that effect.
Yeah, and it's hard.
Do you think that when you watch it now?
Mm.
That in a way it's giving you a hope of something possible from where you are now in your life moving forward.
Oh.
Not just then at that time, but does it also evoke something hopeful about the nature of love now?
Well,
or
sure.
what's possible in the future in any way at all? In other words, do you
think
a film or piece of art only takes us back? Or do you think it takes us forward or across time? What do you think?
That's a big question. So... Mm-hmm.
So when you were thinking of this episode, were you only thinking of what it brought up from the past?
Well, I do agree with the Fireside Theater in We're All Bozos on This Bus from 1971, where one of the characters says, well, the future's not here yet, man.
Mm-hmm.
So I think in one sense, the future's not real in the sense that it's so only the present's real. Like right now, this microphone, we're here now.
Mm-hmm.
This is the real.
Right.
This conversation right now is the most real thing for us right now. I mean,
right.
Of course, that's not the only thing. And then these things are, so I think, but I think the future is, of course, extremely important. Mm-hmm. I mean, right now there's a lot of awareness of the future because of the survival of us. That's a big question. But if you're asking me, is there anything in Valley Girl for the future? The movie's about the future because, I mean, in terms mm-hmm. of the theme, mm-hmm. because love is essentially a creative future. It's a love itself believes in the future. It's predicated on a known actual future. Mm-hmm. So when two people make a life together through either through legal matrimony or shacking up, as they used to say, they're actually making a bet. They're actually betting on hope against hope. Is that they're assuming that Tuesday can be like Monday, and that they're putting their hat in the ring, and they're saying, let's do this, and they're committing to that. And that's. And Valley Girl is about that, because in a way, if you think about it in this more, the way I like to think about it is connected to Romeo and Juliet. It's about blood and law being replaced by something higher. Mm-hmm. In the movie, blood and law is like my tribe and our friends and what they think. That's law. That's mm-hmm. that's unfeeling.
There's
that's
a lot of that in Valley Girl.
There's a lot of that.
Like actually, he's not from the Valley.
He's not from the Valley.
And she's not from West Hollywood. But, she's not punk. He's not right, preppy.
They're upset. Yeah. The
so they're wrong for each other.
They're wrong for each other.
But actually, they're
perfect for each other.
In love. And, yeah. and it's beautiful. Yeah.
You know. Because they're answering to another calling. Right. To put it quite in a very explicit way, it's about love replacing the law, right? Which is not to get preachy, but I think that our as human beings, right. not to get too on the nose, right. but we, and it's not easy to do this, but humans are trying to find a way to live from a place of love mm-hmm. rather than mere custom or, you know,
right.
mere tradition. And, like, and built in that is choice, or what we call freedom of choice. You know, I mm-hmm. I choose you. They choose, they leap into the unknown and they make a choice. And that, the movie's saying, I've talked too much. Go ahead.
No, that's, not at all. Yeah. I mean, it's interesting. And I don't want to give away how the film ends for when people click and go find it. But it's worth the digging.
Yeah.
But it does end on a hopeful end. I guess I'm giving something away. Mm. And anticipatory.
Well, it's a classical.
And mysterious note. And also funny, but I won't say what all happens in the end. But
it's a really
it's just watch it. You'll see. And then report back to us. But well, basically.
It's Northrop Frye talking about how comedy ends.
But it doesn't
in
wrap everything up in a. It doesn't like fast forward us into the future and show us their lives in 10, 15 years. But it ends on this leaning forward note. I'll leave it there where they're going to go forward. And so I'll just
Is there a sequel to Romy and Michelle's high school reunion?
I don't know. I should know that. We got.
I haven't seen it. I think they should do a mini series. I think we should try to contact.
But I want to go way back in the Wayback Machine to like 15 minutes ago when you said this thing about. I'm still interested in this thing you said about the moment that you, in that time in your life where the film took you back to the memory of this girl and young woman.
Sure.
And you about to go to Interlaken.
And oh, yeah.
This idea that a film, and that includes the music and the textures of the costumes and the script and all of it, took you back to this time and brought up lots of thoughts about that time. You did say this thing about also that there was some sort of hopefulness in the way that you felt. And so I find it fascinating that the arts,
aesthetic matters,
if you will.
Aesthetic objects do that.
Aesthetic objects can do that. So in a
way, they are therapeutic.
So it's interesting that sometimes they take us back in time, but they can also take us forward in time or help us be more present in the current time. It's just interesting. And, all art... this is my own assertion, so this is not an official podcast, you know.
Well, this podcast is official, so go.
You know,
go ahead.
Yeah. Manifesto, but it's just to make anything is an act of love and faith in a sense. I mean, for us to make this podcast is, right? There's so many wonderful podcasts. I mean, we could go online here we are making a podcast about Valley Girl
late at night on a Saturday night. That's why I'm not a naysayer
right.
about Rick Linkletter's project with Stephen Sondheim that right. is supposed to be released in 12 years or something.
Yeah.
People say it's unethical and speak disparagingly of that project. Merrily we roll along, but that project is predicated upon love and optimism.
Now, if
optimism.
You don't know what in the world we're talking about,
I know, it's
just
an example. But
don't worry. If you don't know what that project is, we'll yeah. link to that, too. There's going to be a lot of links in this episode. We should probably many. Have like a 10-page document
no,
of
but, links. But you know what I mean? That it's like that right. at certain, Stephen Sondheim's going to turn 100 or something. Or
yeah.
It's just that's the only way to live, really.
Right.
And you have to, and so.
I think it's a primal thing that we make things.
I think it's primal?
I think it's eternal. I think it's,
right.
I mean, you know, it reminds me, I know right. I always talk about this, maybe not to our listeners, because yeah. they've actually never heard me on this show. So it'd be like, who the heck is this person? But I love that, more on that another time. But what I find fascinating mm. as a producer, which to me is mm. just really a word that means storyteller.
Right.
You know? I mean, that's all it is.
Show
means.
Creator.
But just a producer is just somebody who is right. strangely compelled to put something together and put it in the world, yeah. no matter what that takes, right? That's just sort of like in the makeup of what mm. this word producer means. Yeah. But really what that means to me is storyteller. Or story listener.
Well, you're in good
or story
company.
Whisperer, or story, you know, you're, doula. I don't know.
You're basically like Jenny Connor and Bob Evans.
Well, just I don't know about all that. I mean,
no, but that's the
right now.
Job.
I'm sitting in my pajamas right, with a microphone, so I mean, go figure that.
Bob Evans sat in his silk pajamas
oh, well,
a lot.
Well, then and maybe I am in good.
I don't
company.
Know about Jenny Connor.
But what I was, there, but what I mean is like this, yeah. the Buddhist monks, they make these sand mandalas. I'm right. obsessed with this. Hmm. And I'm going to butcher this. So any
Andy
of you Buddhists
Goldsworthy.
Listening who are like, hey, you got the timeline wrong, I'm sorry. I apologize mm. in advance. But I know that some of them can work on them for months,
yeah.
possibly a year. And this intricate process mm. of sand art. I'll link to sand mandals. It'll be on page mm. 10 of the document of links we're going to have this episode.
It'll be a, it have an
make,
appendix.
They make
an appendix. So we'll get a
appendix to the
annotations.
Episode.
Annotations for the... Who knew we were going to have annotations?
Who knew our Valley Girl episode?
So what do you say?
Who knew it would take us... Like, it would be the one with the most links.
You want to tell the listeners what I'm wearing and what you're wearing?
No, we don't. That's a different sort of podcast.
Okay.
But
no, but you know what I mean?
I'm joking.
I'm not in my pajamas.
Somehow we're both wearing plaid, though. But what I was going to say is that they make these intricate objects, if you will, right. these spiritual, I mean, they're spiritual
they
endeavors,
are, yeah.
but anyway, they make these sand mandalas full of colors and designs and patterns, and then they blow them all into the dust. But yet there's this thing about creating something,
yeah.
about making something.
Yeah.
That, and so you may say to yourself, hey, what does in the world does this have to do? What is this episode about anyway? I guess you could say it's about aesthetics. In
it
a sense,
sure.
and about the power
sure.
of aesthetic objects to explore meaning, to communicate, to connect with ourselves, with the world, with something else, whatever
right.
that is you believe in, like the universe.
That's true.
Yeah,
it's, well, you know, Tarkovsky calls it preparing for death.
Hmm.
He calls it plowing, his phrase is plowing and harrowing the soul.
Now, see, I see it another way, even though I love Tarkovsky. I see it as
well. He, yeah.
I see it as
plowing
something eternal.
Soul. That's what he's saying. Same thing.
Something eternal.
He says so. That's future oriented. He's saying you have to prepare.
So let's say right now you're listening yeah. to this podcast yeah. and you're 16.
These two strange.
And you
people.
Don't know what in the world this podcast is about, or even why they're talking about Valley Girl. But something compels you to click the link and watch the film.
Yeah.
And you are, let's say, a teenager of this time.
Oh wow.
Which is quite different than 1983.
Yeah, I don't know.
Now, if you are listening and you are someone of that generation yeah. or any even close to it, it'd be interesting to hear from you. So, by the way, you know. Check our 8-page links and get in touch with us. But
yeah.
I'd be interested to hear people check out the film and say, wow, you know,
yeah.
even though it's dated in the sense that
yeah.
the costumes are from this time
yeah,
or whatever,
yeah.
that there's something in this
yeah.
that's eternal.
Yeah, it's totally
it stands
eternal.
The test of time.
Tense of time. It's a real thing.
But that goes back in a way to...
Artists can do that. It's a real
right.
thing.
But if you think about it, it goes back to
thing.
Why and how a person makes something. Like Martha Coolidge mm-hmm. made this from her heart.
Oh, yeah.
She didn't have to base it on Romeo and Juliet in mm-hmm. a way.
Well, she felt strongly about that play, though.
But right, but
yeah,
if she
so,
hadn't done that, maybe
yeah,
it wouldn't be as eternal.
That's true. Yeah, that's true. I mean, like West Side Story, actually.
Right. Yeah.
Which is an amazing piece of music, mm-hmm. opera. There's a connection there, certainly. I mean, I actually think that everything she makes is that good.
I mean, do you think somebody in an old folks...
I like Real Genius. So, I mean, all Rambling Rose.
Is that another
Rose
film of hers?
Yeah, Real Genius is a wonderful film that science nerds like a lot. Val Kilmer. And the main character's name is Mitch, too, in that.
Oh, well. Yeah, then so. We'll have to do another episode on yeah. that. That'll be in your other podcast about film critique.
Yeah, Real Genius. Yeah. What were you going to say? I'm sorry, I interrupted you.
No, I mean... So back when you made the phone call... I sent you the poster.
Oh, yeah, wow.
What was the first thing you thought about why you wanted to make this episode about Valley Girl?
Oh, I was trying to find a way to get personal. I was trying to find a way to do a personal episode.
Now, why did you want to do a personal episode?
I think there's a place for that.
Mm-hmm.
I want to make space for that. I want to talk about things in my personal life because I've had, you know, I've undergone some revelations about my life, you know.
Mm-hmm.
Having to do with, well, we could do a whole show on that, but having to do it, you know, with Asperger's and all that, and it's a big deal. And,
interesting.
Yeah.
What's Asperger's?
Oh, I can't. Asperger's is hard to define. some people call it high functioning autism.
Interesting.
Some people call it intellectual diversity. That's there's intellectual diversity.
So we're gonna have more links.
No, but I mean, it's interesting because I'm thinking about my life and the entirety of my life in light of this quite recent evaluation.
So this information is new information for you.
It's very new, yeah. Yeah.
That Asperger's is a part of your journey.
Part of my journey, yeah.
So would you say, I'm just curious, this wasn't planned,
mm-hmm.
although we've talked about doing some episodes about this.
Yeah.
But here's what I find fascinating.
Uh-huh.
So you're making a podcast,
mm-hmm.
and you're always thinking of your audience and the journey you're taking them on and the guests you're bringing on and your guest journeys, sharing their mm-hmm. artwork and their experience of their creative mm-hmm. process and their journey as artists and how they began mm-hmm. and where they are now and their mm-hmm. stories, if you will. And so you're thinking of the audience and you're thinking of mm-hmm. your guests. And then at the same time, I find it fascinating with this title, this word, Asperger's, that you created a show. Would you say that your show, this podcast and your musical journey, would you say that there are ways that you bridge to the world within that, let's say, diagnosis or title?
Maybe, yes, possibly.
Mm-hmm.
But that was never my intent.
Sure.
And I never wanted to do a show about psychiatry or psychology.
No, I know, yeah, no.
And I actually never wanted to do what would be called a self-help show.
Sure. None of which you've done so far.
Well, I just feel, first of all, I think there's people that are really good at that.
Yeah.
That's its own genre.
Right.
And I don't really think it's a... Also, I hate giving advice. I've said this before. I don't believe in giving advice. Look, I think there's one person in my life who I suggested they maybe should drink less, and they stopped drinking completely. And they came back, and I guess I gave that person advice, but I was not trying to. So it was once. But I'm just not somebody
so
really...
So you're batting 1,000 anyway. Like, you gave advice once, and it worked out pretty well.
Yeah.
But we won't. That doesn't mean we'll do a whole show.
Well, it's funny, but what I mean is that I'm not here to preach it in anybody, and I'm not really...
But so the title of this show is
about
what?
The arts, I will preach.
What is the title of the show?
It's Journey Even as Thee.
Podcast,
yeah.
Right. So you're on a journey.
Yeah, I am.
You're taking us
on a
journey.
Well, we all are.
Right?
Yeah.
Would you say, do you feel that the arts have been important in your journey?
Are you serious?
In general, but also given this new information about Asperger's, even if you weren't conscious of it, do you think playing piano and films and reading, do you feel like in some way it's been part of your journey from the interior to the exterior?
Well, I think... Diagnostically, I think diagnostically those are my obsessions, right?
Right.
And one of the characters of Asperger's.
But I'm not even speaking diagnostically. I'm speaking metaphysically.
Oh.
Do you feel? I mean, I understand that you're speaking of that, but I'm just saying I'm asking something more aesthetic, actually, and ethereal. I guess I'm asking something a little more less medical.
Well.
Do you think the arts are a way to heal? or a way to...
Oh, I said earlier in this, I think about 20 minutes ago, I said they were form of therapy. They were therapeutic, certainly. Mm-hmm. I don't think they're only therapeutic. I think they're many things. Yeah. Again, I've said on this show that I think they can entertain. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So they could be a way to sort of... They could be a diversion. Mm-hmm. But it could be Tarkovsky's reason, which is really to save your soul. I mean, he puts a high bar. He says it's to save your soul.
I mean,
that's therapeutic.
I'm in the Tarkovsky.
Right. That's a very ideal way to But I think they serve more than one function. But I do. But another thing, too, is that I think everything's aesthetic.
Yeah.
I don't think there's any way around it. I mean, we experience the world with our senses, and we saw color and. If we don't see, then we hear. And
I wish I had this. I'll just link this in page 10 of the appendix. But there is a famous quote, and some whippersnapper listening is going to know exactly who said this, and I apologize. But I am in my pajamas drinking coffee in the middle of the night, you know, on the mic. I didn't think I'd say this. So note to self, prepare even more. But
I'm drinking Sanka. Decaf. I'm not quite on speed with
what
it.
But what I mean is, there's that saying that everything you do in your life is art. I know Bjork said it, but I think she quoted it as someone else's quote, that the way you eat, the way you dress, the way you speak, the way you do your dishes, that everything can be artistic.
I mean, that's...
And that anything can be aesthetic, meaning, let's say you're not a fine... No, I don't mean fun as in good. I mean, let's say you're not a studied artist. Let's say you're self-taught, you're folk artist, or you're, I don't know, whatever. Let's say that your life has been making a home and raising children. There's an aesthetics that is part of aesthetics.
Yeah.
That it's not just for the filmmakers or the writers or the producers or the podcast makers, or it could be the person who works on your car or somebody who, I mean, in other words... Lots of things can fall under the aesthetic umbrella.
Yeah, that's a pretty wide category.
Mm-hmm. But I like that.
Mm-hmm. Well, I is that asking me to what I think about that, or?
Well, I guess I didn't really ask.
Cornel West says I'm here today because somebody loved me. That's what he says about himself. Mm-hmm. So,
don't you think podcasts are a form of love in a way?
Well, they're a radically new genre of art that's very unusual and very exciting. A form of love, well, I mean, that's, yeah, I guess.
What I mean is, I know for me, sometimes I've listened to things, and even if I haven't fully listened, which I'm sure everyone tonight is, or today is fully listening to every word of this, I'm kidding. But a lot of times people like to listen to podcasts for comfort. They're in the room, there's words going on, and there's a voice happening. And even though it is a, let's say, new, and I'm using quotes again, art form, in a way, it's ancient.
It's ancient because it's oral.
The oral
tradition. It's like the shamans. And so, yes, of course, it's 1,000 years old
as
well.
It's interesting, yeah.
It's both. But, I mean, you know, Mark Edmondson, who teaches English, says that when his children were young, that they could watch Shakespeare, and they might fall asleep on it. But they would get something out of it. In other words, when they were awake, something was happening to them. Because he said that he thought Shakespeare was for everybody on some level.
Well, I was so obsessed with storytelling, which is the only thing I've ever wanted to do in whatever form.
Yeah.
So I remember purposely, and I still do this, but at the time, listening to Shakespeare on purpose at night, I had these John Gielgud tapes called The Age of Man. They were on cassette tapes.
I never heard that.
And I was such an obsessive... theater and film art student that I felt like 24 hours a day I needed to either be learning about my craft or absorbing something. So I would listen to these janky cassette tapes. I mean, not John Gielgud. He was not janky.
Tape?
But I mean, like, the cassette
tapes
were
super
worn
tape
out.
Or magnetic.
I wore them out. And it was like Shakespeare's soliloquies and sonnets and monologues, and I would absorb them while I was asleep. Anyway, it was just like, anyway,
you aim high.
Let's go back to Valley Girl, though.
I don't know if I want to go back to Valley Girl.
But this is actually a great example.
I saw John Gielgud, and as I said, and saw Ralph Richardson on the stage. It was remarkable.
But this is really, again, like, so let's say
it's all the same.
You have Valley a frame Girl. With a movie poster of these, and then when you see it,
I framed it in fuchsia.
In fact, you won't even have to link it below. It'll just be in the notes, and it'll just be
up.
Valley Girl. Hopefully, we won't get any copyright trouble.
Oh,
but don't worry about that. That'll be another episode. But we'll have a link or the poster.
I'd love to get Martha Coolidge on the show.
Well, let's try for
talk
that.
About
But back to this thing, this ripple effect of a movie poster leads us to a movie
Madeleine
viewing,
Proust.
Leads us to talking about the past, then leads us to create an episode.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So you could say that aesthetics, aesthetic objects, can take us across time.
Well, they defy time,
And they can also...
They're time-bound, they're also timeless.
And they also take us on a journey.
They do that. And you're going to go on a journey with their dear audience, whether you want to or not.
Right.
You might be on a journey right this moment. We're all on a journey.
So Asperger's is a part of the journey.
For me, it is. I don't... It's certainly not all of who I am. That's a that's a very difficult and separate issue. I mean, I'm an interesting company. David Byrne, Daryl Hannah.
Not doing so bad there.
Yeah,
not
I mean,
too shabby.
And Bill Gates, interesting people. But you know, we're all different.
Mm-hmm.
My thing is the arts. I think I feel I was kind of going to the arts to figure out how I tick, and as I was then.
I am certainly sure that's true of me.
That's interesting.
I mean, I could do my own episode about Valley Girl. It was it's in my top five favorite films.
Hmm.
And even though this podcast isn't so much about me and my journey with Valley Girl,
it could be. I'll just say that it literally
had me shaking in my boots. And even though I was in some small southern corner of the world, I knew that whatever it was I just saw was like another realm of what was possible from what I saw around me. And I actually think that I kind of set my bar on that that's the real ticket right there, and everything else is not really relevant when it comes to love. Like, that's what love is. That's, you know, I mean, and it's a movie, I realize, but it definitely showed me a window into something different.
The character in the film is in a small podunk town. She's in the San Fernando Valley, which is the same as a town in Georgia. There's no difference, right? Thinking of them as...
I mean, to me, that's very sophisticated compared to where I come from, but okay. I mean...
Well, looking at it in a metaphysical sense, sense we're all... So anything could be a small corner. So they're all small corners. So I guess what I'm saying is everything's a small corner. Mm-hmm. And so everybody is just trying to do the best they can, as I said at the beginning of the episode. And
you know what John Lennon said?
I don't know. I'm not a John Lennon expert, but he said a lot of things. But
love is love and love is real.
Yeah. So there you have it.
One of my favorite quotes of his.
Yeah.
Not as long and drawn out, but very powerful.
Hmm.
Love is love and love is real. And Leo Tolstoy, what does he say? Something to the effect, and again, Tolstoy scholars, I'm sorry, I apologize in advance, but something to the effect that everything I know about life I learned from love. So Valley Girl.
Yeah, well, it's about love, so.
Yeah.
Perfect.
Yeah. What else? Is there anything else we need to cover on this?
Oh, I just wanted to thank you for being on the show. It means a great deal to me. And, you know, you are the producer on the show, but without your presence here, we wouldn't be able to probably get into some of this territory as well as we did. So,
sure.
I don't know how you feel about that.
I enjoy being the visible thread that stitches the quilt together, but when necessary, I'm happy to step in. I will say this, though.
Yeah.
I love the idea that whatever we explore, because our mission has been to go across all the arts, and not just arts. I mean, actually the art of how someone lives their life. We have some interesting guests coming up that
for sure, for sure.
That may not for sure. That may not totally that are gonna take us
it's
in different directions. They're
trippendicular
guests
from
the film, in case you wanna know.
I know this.
But like, I just think that for sure is totally rad, you know? Like, for real, to have a podcast.
Hmm. I mean, that's the sound. When I was at back in the days, that's how people sounded.
No, I just was being a dork for a minute, but I'm happy to be on, and I love the journey that your courage and fortitude are taking us all on. And I just want to have a moment here to thank your listeners.
Yeah, we always thank the listeners because it's important.
Because we do really think about them every day.
All the time.
When we're playing, all the time. Yeah. Like, are they going to know what the heck? In fact, we started this episode and then we stopped the record button.
We stopped the record.
To have an art session about what in the world are we doing?
We had to redo it.
Why are we even doing this podcast?
So then we made
Valley
a show
Girl?
About why we're doing it.
That's right. Why
that
are we doing it?
That has become this episode.
So before we close
it's
it out.
It's a meta episode.
It is a meta. Yeah, it's meta and it's micro, but it's meta.
And macro.
It's back to meta and micro.
And macro.
And macro.
Because love is macro, right?
That's right. What else is there? Anything else?
Not right now. I think that's. I hate saying goodbye. Don't you?
I do. I really do.
Don't. But you have to do it sometimes, right?
So I guess we just say so long.
We say thank you for listening to Journey.
Thank you.
Of an Aesthete. And also thank Audible.
Yep. And, absolutely. Our sponsors and Anchor FM
and Anchor.fm.
I think we should thank our audio engineer Kyler.
Kyler Rabb.
Yep.
Kyler Rabb is a...
audio genius.
Yep.
Audio prodigy.
Audio prodigy and Laura Jill Strickland.
Well...
I'm not going to thank myself.
You can just call me L, like a rapper.
Oh, okay. L. All
L. Right. Just initial L.
Okay.
Well, I will say to our listeners, if you have any thoughts about guests you'd like us to have on...
yeah.
Any art forms
within
you
reason.
Want us to explore...
Right.
We're open.
Yeah.
You can get in touch with us.
Yeah.
And we will entertain your ideas.
I mean, I'm just crazy enough, I might.
Yeah.
I'm just, if somebody says I want to have, you know, a
or maybe
carrot
you do,
top on
maybe you do some interesting
delegate.
Art form we don't know about that's that true. We should explore.
Yeah.
All right.
Come on down.
I feel like we should end with some kind of quote or something, but...
No quote tonight.
No quote tonight. All right. Well, I don't like saying goodbye either.
But we're
so we'll
do
see
it.
You soon.
See you soon. Bye-bye.
Thanks. Thank you.